Hey guys, I got quite a few requests to make a video of Alfheim and Boneshaker in real time and showing off the parks as what they actually look like instead of in a video that makes them look a bit better than they actually do. This should be a bit more of a like backstage overview kind of video, which I would have kind of liked to see in the main series. Didn't get that in, so I'm sorry about that, but hopefully this will make up for it a little bit. Also keep in mind that my frame rate isn't the best. I'm running at around 20 FPS right now, but especially when I'm moving around things like that, you might see the frames dropping a bit, and it becomes more noticeable at that point. Definitely not that terrible though, but it's definitely one of the reasons why I do like to avoid, you know, real-time parts of my series and why I like the time-lapse kind of format quite a bit. Anyway, this is what the park looks like. There are a couple of issues that I also want to talk about. A lot of things that I think are wrong with this park that I don't like to talk about in my main videos because I don't want to throw too much self-criticism in there. But I definitely think I can just make this video like one big stream of consciousness about what's behind all this and what my own thoughts about this. And now the most noticeable thing that you might see that you don't really notice in the final video is the entire layout of the park and how it all kind of fits together. There's one big problem that I have with this, and it's that I really don't like the path layouts. It's very messy, it's kind of all over the place. It's just these small paths that kind of circle around the area, but there are no real plazas, except for this one. This place fits into a theme park a bit more, but all of this with all like the paths that are quite narrow and just kind of snake everywhere are not that theme park-ish. Not really happy with how that turned out. I do like it on like a very small scale because I did kind of use them to force a bit more path interaction, but it's a bit more messy than I would have liked. Generally though, I'm quite happy with the layout of the coasters. Actually, kind of like the setting of having the first half over here, which really snakes through the forest, and if I can lower the camera a bit, you can also really notice how this part is quite a bit higher, because at this point, kind of lost speed there, and one of these coasters to go dip down into the valley and keep their momentum going. And yeah, you kind of have that sort of two parts approach to the ride. There's the first part which flies through the forest and over the hills where they still have that dueling action going on. And in the second part, it's just a lot lower and they're more on their own and there's a lot more path interaction. And they really dive underneath a lot of stuff. And just think that's a pretty interesting way of keeping the momentum going. Because one of the things that I really wanted to make sure with these coasters, and which I ruined myself by accidentally slowing them down too much in the main video, is that they kind of keep their momentum throughout the entire ride. About which, by the way, if you didn't know yet, I recorded this with Cheat Engine, and that's how I slowed down the game. With Cheat Engine speed hack, slowed it down about 5 times. Then in post-processing, I took the DX Story video that I recorded in that 5-time slowed down version of the game. DX Story already made it real-time, but I thought that they were a bit too fast. I couldn't really tell the speed of the game in-game, since especially when the game is not paused, it lags a lot more, and I couldn't really tell how fast the coasters were. And I figured at that point, late at night, when I was editing that video, because I was running terribly into the deadline, I figured that I would slow it down a bit more to the speed that I wanted with these coasters, but in reality, it's the real-time speed, which is probably a bit better. The final video, they came out really slow. And just a small shout-out, you can check out on my Twitter, I posted a video of the POVs in real-time, just if you want to check that out. They're quite a bit faster than the final POV came out. But yeah, that's everything about the layout of the coasters. It's not too big of an area, that's also quite interesting. It's, you know, it looks somewhat big in the final video, but I don't think I'm really good at making any kind of really big fantasy epic scale kind of project, and I just kind of messed around a bit with, you know, how I wanted to set up this park to make it look larger than it is. There's obviously the fact that the middle section is really in this kind of valley, which is not as noticeable in the final video, but you really see if you kind of zoom over it, it's much lower than the area around it. And that kind of gives it, you know, a bit more distance if you look toward the castle especially, but especially since the castle is, you know, located on this rock, kind of seems a bit further away. These buildings are slightly placed, you know, to the back of it, just to kind of make that extra forced perspective on making things look further away. But in reality, it's not even that huge. I do reckon this you know, could, at least in terms of scale, fit in a Disney park, though I don't actually see this being built because it does dip into the fantasy side of things a bit with being quite over the top with scenery and all that. It's definitely a really expensive coaster that I won't see any kind of theme park realistically building in real life. One of these B&M inverts I would reckon is about $20 million, which is about the price I think of a large B&M invert, and I've got two of them over here. So that already stacks up to $40 million. I would reckon that the castle costs about $20 million to build as well. And then there's all of these houses around here as well, lots of scenery, a lot of foliage around here too. Many tunnels that you need to dig, and a lot of gardening. I do think this thing in general, if you want to build it in real life, you'll need over $100 million for it, which is not very cheap, and I don't see that happening anytime soon, so in that sense it's not entirely realistic. Well, it's not very realistic. The only real realistic parts that I wanted to keep is to at least make the layouts quite B&M-esque, and to make sure that you can ride them without dying, and that they can physically be built, so not having any floating islands or anything like that. But aside from that, it's quite a fantasy in that I don't see anyone actually putting the money in to build this. There's a couple of interesting things that you don't see in the final video that are in the park, like the little treehouse. I got some comments that I might want to get into treehouses, but I ended up only building one because I, truth be told, was not really very, you know, there wasn't a lot of time left at the end. The deadline was very tight. I only started this park 1 week before the deadline and didn't really have a lot of time left, so this is the only treehouse thing that I came up with. Figured it would be nice to have this at least go around some kind of scenery, so there's the little treehouse. There's the magic twirl, which is pretty cool as well. Definitely seen much better magic twirls, or what's this thing actually called? It is the magic twirl. Huh, interesting. But yeah, definitely seen much better versions of it, and this one's just kind of lame. But I figured it would be nice to have a ride, at least give it a bit more theme park atmosphere, this park. Is there anything else? There's the bridge, which I didn't really focus on too much in the video, which is like a cute little bridge. And I only put this path in here to have the bridge, to have that path go underneath the bridge, so it basically leads to nowhere. That's another stupid quirk in the path. That's something that I definitely don't want to have. There is this side of the park, which I didn't film because it's not finished. In my dreams, I would have liked to see like awesome elvish facades over here, but that didn't happen, so now it's just a very lame, boring entrance. The only thing that it has going for it is that if you walk through this gate, you see the castle being framed at the end of it, which is pretty cool. But that's just about it there. And some other things that aren't as noticeable, we've got the queue layouts over here, which kind of goes underneath the coaster. I didn't want to interact that a bit, and goes underneath this path as well. Didn't want to make the queues a little bit interesting. I obviously didn't have much time to work with them that much, but you know, if you're in a theme park, you're still gonna have to spend quite a bit of time in the queue, so might as well make them look interesting. And this is the one for the other ride, the Dark Elf, that would be. I'm not even going to try to pronounce them because I'm really terrible at Norwegian. And yeah, that is basically everything I think that I missed or didn't really show off in the final video. Another, well, small things that I would kind of like to talk about, some small critiques that I have for myself, would be that I'm not that happy with the layouts. I think they can still be quite a bit smoother than they are in the game right now. One of the issues that I made, and this is really going to be something that I'm going to want to keep in mind for next coasters, is that I didn't entirely finish the coasters before I added the scenery. I didn't entirely smooth out every section of the track. And in the end, I ended up with parts like this, which is like very awkwardly banked, and that definitely shouldn't have been the case, and it's just a very unsmooth part. But if I actually try to edit this and say I want to, you know, curve this around, it's like, for some reason it turns up red, and you can't do that, just goes back to where it was. And I removed the wood on top of this, and even all the bushes around here, and it still won't let me do it. And just in general, you get a lot of, like, annoying problems with scenery like that. But I definitely shouldn't blame it all on that. I just think the layouts in general could have been better at a few places. Like, the zigzag part over here, while I do kind of like the concept behind it, isn't very shaped like a B&M. The zero G rolls are terrible, there's no hard lining in them. They might be somewhat smooth in the final video, but hardlining is something that I absolutely still struggle with and that I want to find a couple of, you know, ways to do better in the future, because it is still quite tricky, but it is a very important part of making roller coasters, especially when you're making a B&M. And in general, the buildings could have also been laid out a bit nicer. There, you can kind of tell the general idea that I wanted to have the castle in the middle and these buildings kind of building up on the sides. But it would have been cool to have like a building over here and here, just to fill it up a bit more, have a bit more of a build up toward the middle, and have some more facades around here because it's quite empty. But that's just about the biggest things that I can think of. There are always like little things that you learn while building stuff, and it's why I think the best way to improve might just be to, you know, build things. No matter how terrible you think they are, you can always learn a bit from them, and I think everybody's their own biggest critic, so that's a thing to keep in mind as well. And it's also, you know, I think it's never really a good idea to start judging your things too much if they're not even finished yet. I mean, through halfway building Alfheim itself, I was really insecure about how it would actually turn out and if it was even any good. Now, to finally talk about something that I've been wanting to talk about for a while, and this is the best opportunity to do so, the contest. Alfheim was made for a contest, and you might want to ask, well, how did it do on it? It actually did really well. I got placed second out of some really amazing entries, and then there were still many entries that weren't shown in the thread, or some really amazing creations that weren't entered into the competition. I'll put a link down in the description to the thread and also to the winning video. Basically, I do remember a couple of like the first few entries. The first one was Coaster Cat Dragon Kingdom, which is really amazing. I've seen some comments saying, you know, some other kind of entries might have won, which, you know, in the end, it's still quite subjective, but I do think it's very well-deserved win. It's a really huge park. It's a really amazing park. It does some things that none of the other entries really do, not the ones that I've seen at least, and that Alfheim doesn't do for sure either. It's got some, like, very big terraform dragons in there, some huge terrain-following coasters, and even some, like, foliage artwork, and just a lot of very unique and creative things that I think, especially with the grading criteria that the contest had, just scores better than the rest of the things out there. But even the rest of the things that were made are really awesome. I do remember Kukamonda was third with his flying coaster, which is also really good. To be very honest, before the competition, we didn't know who actually entered their things in, so I was partly placing my bets on Kukamonda, but still being third is a really great achievement. And his coaster is just absolutely amazing. It's quite similar actually to Alfheim, and was actually one of the biggest inspirations for it as well. Then fourth was the Lady Designer with a magic twirl ride with some really cool theming around it. And fifth was Oakwood Adventures, which was the only like realistic park out of the entries, which was also one that I was sort of figuring, to be very honest, before the competition started. I figured that one would win the competition, but I obviously didn't know, well, who would actually enter it. And Dragon Kingdom was one that kind of surprised me, and I think many other people as well, because it wasn't as well known. And Coaster Cat is definitely not as well known as a creator. And I think, honestly, that's also part of the point of the competition. Looking at the rules of the competition, everyone who entered signed an agreement that anything that would enter the competition could be used for promotional images or videos or anything that Frontier wants to use to promote the game. And I think it kind of ties into that as well. One of the big issues that personally I still have with the community creations video, but I think many people have as well, is that it featured a lot of my things, but for a community creations video, the amount of community people that were actually in it is very small, and this competition seemed like a very good way for Frontier to get to know some other creators, find some smaller creators who aren't as well known but still create really great stuff, and, you know, actually give them a spotlight, which is a reason why I am not entirely sure why it's such a low profile contest. Like, I still got many comments on my videos asking what contest I was talking about. They don't really promote the contest as much, but I do hope that they're, you know, still going to use the entries as a way to promote the game and actually go ahead and make that agreement quite useful and use these videos that were entered for the contest for promotional, you know, videos and anything for the game. Because it would be really cool to see that, and also a great way for Frontier to interact more with the community, which I think they already do quite well. But there are just some people who get like a spotlight and others who don't, even though there are many people out there who make great things, but just aren't as well known for it. And it would be, you know, a great way to actually get the community to build by having less of a spotlight on certain people and focusing more on what people create. And, you know, personally, I think that's what makes communities like these so good as well. I don't even really like the contest sort of vibe, because what I think makes communities like this so great, having been in the Rollercoaster Tycoon 3 communities for years, is the fact that they're not really competitive, but they're much more supportive. Like, the community really builds on each other, and you can't really draw out one person while forgetting about the rest of the community, because everybody just builds on each other's stuff. Like, you see other people build certain things and you get inspired by it, or like somebody discovers a trick and it kind of, you know, gets spread around. And I think it's most visible in Rollercoaster Tycoon 3 because it started off as that one game, which is really cartoony in the beginning, but after 10 years of, well, more than 10 years by now, of, you know, the community working with the game and making custom content for it and sharing all kinds of tips and tricks about the game, like, what everybody makes just gets a lot better. And I think that's the kind of thing that I would personally really love to see happening with Planet Coaster, because I'm still just, you know, the Rollercoaster Tycoon 3 community has a special place in my heart, I guess. And, you know, it would be great to see the kind of thing happening to the community where there's not so much a spotlight on certain people, but it's just more about the community themselves in general, you know, with everybody in it moving forward and, you know, building on each other and just making more great stuff in this game. And nobody can do that alone, and you can't really draw anybody's, well, individual buildings out of it, because it just builds on what other people have built as well. My stuff is definitely inspired with by what Kukumona has made. I can definitely get inspired in the little things by anything that anyone makes, and there are just, you know, all those ways in which everybody builds their things with the things that other people have, you know, had in mind, or you look at what somebody has made and you think, I kind of want to make something like that. I think it's that kind of nature of a community like this that makes it such a, you know, a good potential for a really amazing community, even though the Planet Coaster community is obviously just, you know, it's still starting and the game is still in a very early alpha, perhaps too early to talk about things like that. I think that this competition is just a good way to bring it out there more. Basically what I'm saying, but what I'm kind of talking around, is that while people like me and some others are really famous and well known within the community, there are just so many more people who make amazing things, and even if you don't see them, it does, you know, shine through in what I do, and I definitely wouldn't be able to do this if I was just on my own. And that's just food for thought, I guess. I also wouldn't be able to do this though if I would stop self-criticizing, so definitely I'm probably my biggest critic myself, and I try to keep it out of my regular videos a bit, because I do remember getting quite a few comments that I should do it less, but yeah, I'll just unleash that in this video. And the next thing that I want to unleash it on is Boneshaker, so I guess that's a terrible segue. That's a terrible subway, yeah, I'm gonna get into Boneshaker and show that off for a second here. So here's Boneshaker, and with a much more comfortable FPS, that's very nice. What's not so nice about this though is that personally I don't like Boneshaker as much. I think it's a bit too spread out, could have definitely been laid out quite a bit better. I think most of all it's a collection of things that I like, but it doesn't feel as coherent as I would have loved it to be. I like this section in terms of how it's laid out, but then this just feels very random and, you know, not fitting with it. And I like this section of the coaster with the hill, which was definitely one of my biggest things that I wanted to make sure would look quite good and a big focus for me, but it also doesn't feel like it has that much of a connection with the rest of the area. In the end, it feels just like, I guess a project that I wanted to throw some nice ideas at. But in the end, I'm not really sure how well it all fits together, but this is basically how it looks if you look at it from the air. And for some reason, There's this weird glitch going on with the color of glass and some other things as well, where everything gets really black, which I'm not sure why it happens, but it basically almost always happens as soon as a new day arrives or I open a new park. Not really sure what's up with that glitch, but just so you know, that's why everything looks a bit weird. I think it also happened in the final video, actually. I think this is actually a comfortable enough FPS to unpause the game with. Yeah, that should still do. It's a little bit laggy, but it's more or less okay. But yeah, this is basically how the coaster looks. It is a very small coaster. I didn't want this to be a family coaster. Could fit into a park like Disney or Orlando. Orlando, what? Or Universal, I figure. Though, you know, I do have to say, it's a completely different theme. I don't see it fit into any theme park theme-wise, but it wouldn't be as expensive as Alfheim. And would definitely be, you know, still on the realism side of things in terms of not being too expensive to build and being something that pretty much the entire family can hopefully enjoy. Would have liked to run two trains on this though and have some sort of cool steampunk car with gears around it and things like that. But that's just really wishful thinking. So it goes around at a pretty moderate speed. Also didn't want to make it too fast. Don't want to make it a very forceful ride since it is, you know, a family coaster in the end. And it's more about the interaction that it has with the scenery and the immersion into the theme that I wanted to work on, rather than, you know, being a very cool coaster on its own, which I also have to say, I'm more about the scenery and I'm more of a scenery person. And while I'm really into roller coasters, especially because, you know, a lot of coaster enthusiast friends or just in general, having been part of the Roller Coaster Tycoon 3 community for such a long time, I'm just, you know, a real scenery person, and that's why I kind of like building rides like these most. This is the area which I'm not really happy with, just really empty, there's not much happening here. Don't see much of a connection to anything else. I figured I wanted to have this flat ride because even though it doesn't look very steampunk, steampunk is about the blimps and air balloons and that kind of thing, so I figured a small air balloon ride could fit quite well into the theme, even though the colors don't look that great. I do think the platform actually looks a little bit steampunk. It's got the steampunk colors and a metallic kind of patterns into it. I suppose the queue could have had a bit more scenery around it, but I do kind of like the interaction it has with the track around here and the crane, which actually does have a small counterweight at the back of it, though I am not a crane master. I probably messed that up quite a bit. And you also notice there is basically nothing at the back of this hill. It's everything is basically on the front, and there isn't any scenery where I didn't, you know, have any visible parts, so it's not as interesting as it might look from this side. And a lot of this is also really built up. Like, it looks like a very compact and sort of weaving coaster over here, but a lot of that basically has to do with the way it's set up and the terraforming is, because if you look from straight up, it's really not that impressive, I think. It's just a really simple coaster with a lot of scenery around it. But the one thing that I do kind of like about this one is the way that this is all set up, as messy as I think the rest of it is. And then there's the restaurant over here, and I'm getting some awkward shadows, so I want to pause the game for a second before it gets any dark around here. The small restaurant, which I guess could have also had a few more details around it. Definitely happy with the shape of the restaurant, but I didn't want to over-detail it too much. But perhaps if I could go back to it, I would make these windows a bit more custom. There's a lot of white in this window and in the rest of the main street in general. One of the things that I definitely want to avoid with my future stuff, and especially right now with the Alpine or German park, I should say, that I'm making, is to avoid these like standard color schemes. This, you know, this brick texture that you see reoccurring everywhere, and this white of the concrete that you see just about everywhere. Because like I've said a couple of times, as much as you put these details into each other to make new things, you can't get rid of the colors and you can't recolor things, and you'll always end up having the same texture, and that's something that I kind of want to avoid right now, because it's just one of those things that makes every creation in Planet Coaster at least to some extent look alike. Oh wow, a couple of mistakes that I still made. I thought I actually put some planks on top of this thing, but apparently I didn't. So when you zoom out, it just disappears. Oh right, I did put planks on this side, that is interesting, but I didn't around here. Same goes for the station, I actually quickly put planks for that for the final video, but I didn't save that version of the save file. So here you see the roof of the station disappearing because of LODs. So that's a little bit strange, but it's no big issue. What's also quite funny, actually, is the backsides of these buildings. I think this one's actually quite interesting, because I still get quite a few comments about, you know, if I'm not worried about stacking all of these things into each other, as in, it's very inefficient, it's probably a nightmare to look at if you're any kind of programmer or designer. Believe me, I am not the biggest fan of doing this either. It's just a necessary evil, I figure, for making things like this. Because if you, you know, want to add a bit of extra detail to your buildings, like this building over here, which just has details just about all around it, you do end up with all of these parts of the pieces that you're using that you don't see, but that still get rendered by the game. And while I've talked about this quite a bit, I haven't really shown it off yet. So to take this facade, for example, there are flag poles over here that I sunk into the building to make that sort of white hook that kind of sticks out from the building, which would be used to like hoist things up to higher windows. That's the idea behind it generally. And there's all sorts of arches and things that go inside the building to make these new details. But there are just so many pieces, like the rest of the flagpole, which you don't see, but which still get rendered by the game, and that is what creates a lot of lag. So if you go into like the back of this building, you can see a lot of messy stuff in here, and this is all kind of stuff that the game renders that lags your game, but that you don't actually see in any of the videos. And that is just a big issue and something that I wish I could avoid. But to be very honest, while I do want to look at my polys a little bit, and you'll probably see me at least, you know, go for the lowest poly options that I can go for in the future, I do still think the way it looks is more important to me, and I just want to experiment with these things as much as I can. I just think it's, you know, going to be important for the game, because it's got the basics down very well. It's a really intuitive and very nice to use building system, and the mechanics of the game work really well. But I think there will just have to be a lot more content in following months just to make up for this problem that we have at the moment. That, you know, everything looks fine and dandy and like you're actually building buildings, but in reality you're just sticking a bunch of objects together in a way that they're not even meant to be stick together to make these buildings, but you do end up frying your computer in the process. So, yeah, I think an important step in the future is to get more content into this game, because that's one of the things where, you know, personally, I think it's still missing quite a lot, which is, of course, you know, very logical. It's still very early alpha, and I think it's good as well. I mean, obviously, the features, mechanics, and core of the game are much more important, but it's definitely something that will be quite game-changing in the future. I don't necessarily think adding more details will make it possible to make much more things, because, you know, this game, this building system is already very flexible, and you can already do quite a lot with the details that we have. I just think it's gonna, you know, optimize the game quite a bit. At the moment, it looks like you can just plop these buildings down, whereas in reality, they're, you know, just painstakingly put together with a ridiculous amount of details that you kind of don't want to do. So to sum everything up a bit, in the end, I'm really happy with how these parks came out. Well, I've definitely got a lot of criticism about, you know, many things of the parks, but very proud that Alfheim actually got placed second. And Boneshaker, in the end, while it's definitely a very flawed ride, I think, it's just been a really good learning experience so far, much like Grizzly Valley, and a lot of things that I can take away from it. And I think the biggest takeaway from both of these parks, and what I personally think is my biggest mistake, and like, well, pretty terrible thing actually for part of these rides, is the way that the layout is just quite incoherent, and that's definitely something that I want to practice with a bit more. I still really feel like I have to get used to this path system, and how I should, you know, lay out the parks without a grid system, because as much of a hassle as a grid was, I do feel it has been kind of, you know, something to hold onto in Rollercoaster Tycoon 3 after so many years of just building theme parks with grids. Having no grid is a lot of freedom, but it's also kind of hard to handle that freedom for me, it seems. And my next step, I think, you know, out of the many things that I can take away from these rides, is to work on the layout a bit more, and that'll definitely be one of the things that I want to focus on with Necker Park. Actually work more on layout and the composition of a theme park, instead of, you know, looking at the smaller sections of parks and just kind of slapping ideas together, like I feel I've been doing mostly with Boneshaker. But yeah, that is right about it for this video, so thank you guys for watching. And if you, well, manage to go through this video all the way at the end and actually listen to more than 30 minutes, I think, by this time of just stream of consciousness of me, then thank you very much. That's really impressive. I don't think I'd even be able to actually bear that myself. And yeah, I hope to see you guys with the next adventure, which will most likely just be a Germanic park with a bit of Scandinavian and Dutch thrown into the mix, probably. And we'll see how good that goes. Also, I hope to make some tutorials sometime soon, so stay tuned for that. Bye, guys.